The creative community is brought to you in part by a generous grant provided by the Diana and Simon Rabb Foundation.
Freund, and I was the director of the TV station when we started the show. And the reason we started the show, I remember how it started. I was sitting next to Guy Smith at a meeting when they were talking about Richard Florida's book about creative commerce. The whole idea of the creative, you know, actually a creative community and how communities can make lots of money and be thriving through creative endeavors that, you know, that and I turned to Guy and I said, this is a great idea. We should do a show on the creative people in Santa Barbara. And about the same time, David was had come to the TV station for us to record a play, I think, that he had written and was being performed at City College. And we talked to David about it because Guy was at City College and David's at City College. And David said he'd love to try to host that. And that's how it fell into place. I think the challenging part was that, well, one challenging part is David's so darn tall that, you know, we had to adjust the cameras and everybody else looked like a dwarf next to him or they were sitting in a hole. The other part was that David had no experience doing this, but what I liked was he grew into it really quickly. And I would say this even if you weren't here, David, but he was always prepared. So he really prepared. He made his guests feel at ease and he really enjoyed. This brought a lot of enthusiasm to the show, and I think that really helped. Even when people were nervous, and there are a few people who are uncomfortable or give short answers, he would draw them out. He really knew about their backgrounds, what they'd done, and I think his preparation made a big difference in making people feel comfortable, and his interest. And then every once in a while we did a field shoot, so that was fun. We'd sort of enhance the show by going out and getting B-roll, or else we'd actually interview someone in the field. And I guess for me, I've been in television, well, for a long time, by accident originally. But what I like about it is that first of all, the continuity of it. I mean, it's great that it went on for so long. But it's also great to have this archive of artists and poets and writers, playwrights, and the whole creative group of people in Santa Barbara, and not only nurtures and encourages that, but it's a record of it, it's a chronicle of it. So I really value that. So this is one of the favorite projects that I've ever been involved in the last 20 or 30 years in television.
TV Santa Barbara is a fantastic resource in the community to be able to provide programming like the creative community, in that commercial media may not have been able to support the program, especially over a period of 10 years, you know, to highlight local artists and local arts. It's not something that commercial media really attracts a lot of viewers for. So the nonprofit media sector is vital to help increase those type of voices in our media, diversity, and help to expose the rest of the community to the wonderful artists and art that's occurring here in Santa Barbara.
Well, I think it's wonderful to let the local community know who is out there as artists, because most of us don't have too much of a profile in Santa Barbara, and this lets people know how many artists there are. And our community has many, many artists. So that's very important.
Because his creative community show was such a great thing for the creative community here, and all the people that he interviewed and gave us in-depth ideas about all the wonderful people in this community who create. So I understand you're expanding, so we're glad to hear that.
It definitely, of course, gives recognition to the artists. But even more important, I think, it's a timeless resource. I think that all of the episodes should be in the special collections at UCSB. And it's as if it's a reference for anyone, as well as it could be a book, except it's not. It's really live and spontaneous. And David is an excellent interviewer.
First of all, poetry is a small teapot, you know? It's a little, little teapot. If there's storms in those little, little teapots, it's really sad. And I think that the poets of Santa Barbara realize that. and know that we are blessed to be in a gorgeous teapot here. And why fight? Why create storms? And so we come together and celebrate one another. Although I wish there was a place we could all reunite that was a regular place with chairs where we could read more poetry. So that's, and read to each other, but also read poetry from other poets. And I wish there was a place like that here. And that's my job. I'm going to work on that. Whereas in New York, it's more how many books you've not written, or how many books you have written, and what press published those books, because it's not only to have a book published, it's what press publishes you. It's very sad. I think New York should come and get some lessons from us, because we're very good at that. Also, what I'd like to do is every time a poet from Santa Barbara has a book coming out, I love to throw a party and have everybody come and celebrate that book. And so I hope a lot of books will be taken, because I like giving parties.
Well, I think for the artists, you know, it's always really great to be recognized and included and validated. And to be asked onto David's program was like a real honor. And it was great. You could, you know, tell your family and friends, hey, you know, check us out on YouTube. And so, you know, on a personal way, it was great for the artists. I don't know what it does for the non-artists, except to let them know that there's life out there other than, you know, shoot 'em ups and The Sopranos. There's life beyond The Sopranos, David. Yeah.
Well, I think what David is doing, has been doing, and hopefully continuing to do is phenomenal. And as Seasons is, big champion of the arts in Santa Barbara for a very small community. We are blessed with the amount of artistic people in all arts. I think it's a great thing to do that. So I'm looking forward to the next level of what David is planning to do. Leslie?
No, absolutely. And I find it's interesting because anytime anybody approaches me about being in a story or pitching a story as a writer or something, I always kind of research who they are and what they're about. And 9 times out of 10, they've been on the creative community. So I watch the interview and kind of use that as part of my research and decision-making process. So it's been really fun. Well, I think a lot of what makes Santa Barbara special, aside from the obvious geographic blessings, is sort of the creative vitality in this community. But it's also a really expensive place to live. So I think it's important to expose the artists and the singers and the dancers and the people that aren't necessarily, you know, living in the gorgeous houses in Montecito, but are making a big contribution to the community. So we definitely try to do that in the magazine, and I think you try to do that in the show as well.
I totally agree. I think what he was doing and continuing to do and what we do really puts our finger on the pulse of the artistic community and people like Diana and Simon, you know, who champion this and make it all happen. In your case, it's a wonderful thing that we're very blessed to live here. And I know I'm speaking for myself, and I think for Leslie, that we are able to put forth this realistic picture of Santa Barbara and the artistic community here in Santa Barbara. And I thank you, David, for what you've done and what hopefully you'll continue to do. And we're there, so let's continue this.
There you go.
So.
Well, I'll tell you, this is, we used to say that the reason for the show is to create an archive of all the creative people who have come through Santa Barbara, who've lived in Santa Barbara, and that is what the show has done. All these episodes, whether it's on DVD or online, it's just an incredible resource to show who in this community has been creative, and it truly has worked to create a community, because through the people that I've seen on the show and who've been on the show, and I've connected with them online, and it's just a great way to build community. So, I mean, the name just says it all.
So I just got an email today from Ernie, which he says, thank you very much, David, for starting his career with his book. And it's changed his life ever since you interviewed him. So thank you very much.
And we are so grateful to the creative community. And over the years, I've had a few chances to be on and get to talk about my own work.
They're the best episodes. Sorry.
Get to hear about people's talking about their own work, what inspired them. It really was about community and brought us all together. I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, Santa Barbara's got an incredible community that I don't think people cherish enough sometimes. You know, people think of it as a temporary community or everybody up from LA, but there's people here that are doing a lot of really interesting things, and it's nice to have a show that helps point that out. So thank you, David.
Yeah. And David's always been a really fantastic interviewer, and he has an ability to get people to relax and be able to talk about themselves without feeling awkward. So if he were here now, I think I would probably be doing much better than I am.
That bit where he can make everyone cry, too, is amazing. Every interview, he breaks them down.
Yeah, I think my last creative community was to honor Barry Spax in his passing. So my Spax Street shirt. And I cried a lot during that show. So it's been wonderful to be a part of it, and lots of laughs and lots of cries.
Santa Barbara, I had some fun watching other people's, you know, interviews as well. I remember seeing Kimberly Hans and Nancy's and Jane Deering, who's a gallerist. So, yeah, it's nice to see who's out there and feel like you're part of a bigger community, because, you know, working in your studio alone, you can be cut off at times. So it really felt, you know, like that reach that you want if you're creating something that's artistic. You don't want it just for yourself, you know. Yeah.
Okay, so Creative Community is a wonderful show with a sparkling, dynamic host. But it wouldn't exist, of course, without a wonderful framework. And that framework is TVSB. TVSB exists to provide a place for shows like Creative Community and to serve the community in a variety of ways. I mean, Creative Community is really a perfect model of the kinds of shows that TVSB wants to do, because it brings value to the city of Santa Barbara by showcasing, in this case, the arts, artists, cultural events, the wonderful cultural organizations that exist in Santa Barbara. And as you guys know, TVSB is all about nonprofits, and it's all about telling viewers in Santa Barbara everything that's going on in the nonprofits of Santa Barbara.
Creative Community is just wonderful. So many people have said, are you on TV? It makes you a celebrity overnight, even though you're just a poet. And one time my children were visiting and they turned on TV at 6 a.m. I guess that's the spot Creative Community got. And they said, Mom, you were at the Channel Islands. You were scaling up a cliff. You were in a boat. David, I don't know how we ever survived that trip, but it was true wilderness and really, really a beautiful experience to be on the Channel Islands and with other endangered species besides the poets.
You know, Glenda, one time you brought Al Young on the show.
Yes, poet laureate Al Young. And I thought I was just delivering him for the interview, but he said, oh no, you have to be on it too. So I think that was probably my first time on the Creative Community, and I was really thrilled, and thank you for giving me a place there. So it's made us truly a community. I think poets get solitary for some reason. Maybe they have to be, but this has helped us all join together, and it's given us so much support from outside, too, because we are seen as unified as the canaries in the coal mine. So we had a good time.
What I think of it? I think it's extraordinary, actually. And I wonder also how it will continue to exist as Santa Barbara becomes more and more a rich person's place. You know, as we know, the vacancy rental rate is less than 1%, and rents are rising, and how are artists going to survive in this place? It's not the texture and fabric of the population has changed a lot. So I don't know what's going to happen. But I mean, I think the variety of people, artists and musicians and any other kind of, you know, I don't really like the word creative very much. I think it's overused. No offense. I'm going to be sorry when I see this, aren't I? But I think there are incredibly intelligent, interesting people in Santa Barbara. And I worry about how that can continue with how much it costs to live here anymore. And that's my same worry about New Orleans, too, is that it's getting it's not as expensive as Santa Barbara, but it's getting more expensive. So.
Well, the connection between Ventura and Santa Barbara, for me, I think it started when I started to attend some of the workshops here in Santa Barbara, either at Westmont or through the Santa Barbara Poets workshops, the summer workshops, which were phenomenal. I got to meet a bunch of wonderful people. David Starkey was one of them, Perry, Chris Yost, Chris Buckley, a plethora of wonderful poets, Gudrun, Ron Alexander. And then I attended one of David's classes and got to meet a whole additional plethora of poets. And it's a very vibrant community here, as it is in Ventura. And I thought there should be more overlap. There should be more integration. And we have a weekly poetry series in Ventura, and we have a lot of friends from Santa Barbara that come down and regularly attend, and they really round out our mix. And we've been invited, both Fernando and I have been invited up to Santa Barbara to read or to participate in writing assignments, if you will. And I love the group of poets here. So I like that we're a little more integrated than we were maybe 5 years ago. And I wonder how much of that is due to creative community.
I moved from Los Angeles to Santa Barbara, and I ended up taking a class with David. And my gosh, I can't believe he still talks to me. I was young, arrogant, convinced I was the best writer in the world. And that was only like a couple weeks ago. So, no, that was many years ago. But just being in the community and knowing that there was a place to share your poetry and develop your work and learn from other poets was great. The Poetry Zone was one of the first places that I would read at. And then I ended up moving out to Ventura. So I became part of that community, but stayed in contact and drove back and forth between the two. And the more readings, the better. The more locations that we can hear poetry and share our poetry, I think we need more. Or we need them more often. David. Dan, you could call him an up-and-coming poet. David and I met at a party and a gathering for Joyce Lemaire. And Artists Without Limit came up in conversation. And David asked if I would interview or meet with Dan LaBellart, and people pronounce his name differently, but that's the one I'm going to use right now. And so we meet, and I have all these ideas that I'm going to craft him into this wonderful poet. But then after reading a lot of his work, I found that what he really needed to do was just share, get out, stand in front of microphones, send out his work, and mm-hmm. have it published, because he is phenomenal. And since that time, I think he's off to Vermont now,
mm-hmm.
working on
his MFA,
and I think in poetry. So, and we've stayed friends. It was a wonderful opportunity to meet somebody who I may never have had a chance to. And I think in meeting with Dan, he also came out of a little shell, or came out of hiding, and he's really had the opportunity to share his work. And I think people in the world that get to hear him are very lucky. He's an amazing writer.
I brought my hammer and my hardy, which is a chisel that I use to cut the mosaic smalti. I brought it to your studio, and I remember I was a little bit nervous, and I was afraid that when I was doing the demo that I wouldn't hit it right, but I managed to do that because you have to hit it very precisely in order for the smalti, which is the handmade Venetian glass that I use in my mosaics. You have to cut it exactly right, or it either doesn't cut or it shatters. So, but I managed to pull it off.
Well, I was lucky that David, we actually did my segment at my house instead of in the studio, so that was kind of fun, and it took a little pressure off me because I could kind of point at things, and we got to kind of walk around and do a little bit of that. So that was really I don't remember a thing that I said because you can't remember afterwards, and then you're going, what did I say? And I'm sure I'll do that after this one. What did I say? But all I remember was a lot of fun, and it was really great. So, and it was fun to have David in and do his thing, and we're glad he's going to continue to do his thing. So thank you, David, and thank the Rabs for continuing on. It's wonderful to have people in the community to support this kind of programming. So.
And I love the little moments where we stage David's entry into the house. It's a little bit like Mr. Rogers coming into his neighborhood, and he didn't have a pair of slippers to put on, but it was a nice little transitional moment, the arrival of David at the house, and it was very comfortable, of course, and it's the place where I live with this profuse material, and so it was initially very convenient, but also I think it kind of created a warmer atmosphere for the interview.
Je ne sais quoi.
Well, I think it's that anytime people can look at Mary and hear her laugh and see her smile, that's going to have more of an impact than a story in a.
Hey, Madonna. It's more spontaneous, obviously. It's more direct, and I think we're really in a time where visual culture is kind of dominant over specifically reading only, just text only, and so having a visual component. For instance, when you came to my studio to film and got to see the whole gamut of what I was working on and then honing down to the one book you were featuring, it was a different kind of experience from me just waving my hands and trying to tell you about it. So I think the visual really adds a layer to the experience that people have come to expect almost. You know, I mean, you look at a video. I was just listening to, you know, with Nina Simone and her new documentary In the Air and all of that. People kept directing me to YouTube videos, you know, not to her albums, which I have and love, but to the YouTube videos. So I think it's much more of a visual culture right now. Oh, you're always fighting against being dumbed down. I mean, throughout time, I think. And I think there's a real struggle with that right now of wanting some immediate soundbite kind of answer, which is, I guess, what you're saying. And a more thoughtful response, you know, a long New Yorker article rather than some clip in the, and yeah, it drives me nuts, but.
But also it depends on the questions that are asked, because good questions can elicit very good responses. And I think that some of your shows were particularly good because of the questions. I mean, you asked us really good questions that there weren't a lot of dead moments in that. So And you have a way of an easy rapport so that you put people at ease. So I think that they're much more, there's a much better chance that you're going to get a real response rather than something that's just off the cuff and you regret afterwards that you said something. And there's space to answer. I mean, I tend to speak slower than a lot of people, which also means that I tend to think before I speak, which can drive people a little bit crazy. But I was a witness, or I was in a court case where it drove the other attorney crazy because it was like, come on, and the judge finally said, stop badgering the witness, you know, let him speak, I enjoy it. But you do that, you let people talk, and you ask good questions.
It was really good to just see the work visually and then talk about it with you. I was kind of going through the transition at that time, and it made me just kind of take stock in my whole kind of history of where I came from. You know, I came from New York City as far as grad school, and then moving here and the transition. So it helped me to just get a kind of an overview of my own work just by discussing it with you. And it was great. And I think, I don't know if I was at the time working on this book, and I talked about how I wrote, I used my own paintings as prompts for poetry. So that was kind of nice because you're a poet, so it was nice to be able to share that and talk about how just looking at even abstract work can bring up imagery and ideas that I didn't even expect, you know. So it was definitely helpful for me to take stock in what I've done, because sometimes you just go along, and you don't really pay attention to the transitions and the progress that you're making.
I do have some memories of just trying to find the right shirt that would look good for you. And, you know, interview questions that would people would be interested in hearing the response of. And then you had some pretty famous interviewees, too, so that was kind of exciting. Erica Zhang, I remember. You met at the Biltmore, and I'm going blank, but I just remember, I know, Pico Iyer. I was starstruck for that interview because that's someone that I admire and love the writing of, so that was, wow. And Mike DeGree, that was a fabulous, I think that was one of the best interviews, and I think it won an award.
Do you remember anything about Daddy doing the show at first when it started?
You went
to the station one time, right?
Yeah, when I was sick.
Okay, what was it like being there, watching the production?
I guess it was kind of cool. I was also like 5 years old, but
Did you think your dad was like a star?
Kind of.
Aw, okay.
All right, well, thank you.
Well, David really made me feel comfortable, and that was a real benefit, because I'm not used to being on the media. I used to be a disaster worker, and once in a while I'd get interviewed, but not for this length of time. So that was very nice that he made me feel at ease.
I remember I was on with Lois Kline, and we were interviewed as a duo. And Lois is also a poet and instrumental in organizing events in Santa Barbara. And I remember singing to David. And David David seeing me the next time and saying, the actress, which is true, of course.
Okay, so yes, my poetry is very personal. I write about my family a lot. And so I was very concerned about, in choosing my work to read on television, about, you know, letting someone know this is what I do, but at the same time not offending anyone in my family. I failed. I had no idea that my 92-year-old mother in Utah would somehow see this program, but she did, and she was not amused. But otherwise, I did hear from people in town and from friends who had seen it, and they were all excited. So, and so was I. So it was great.
One of my favorite episodes, I got to tell you, one of my favorite episodes was when we took a group of poets out to Santa Cruz Island. David had led a group of poets to Anacapa Island and done an episode of the creative community out there before. And then I went along when they went out to Santa Cruz Island and had poets reading there on the island. And that was fun because I led hikes there and I was able to talk a little bit about the island and give some background about the environment.
What I loved was when someone I barely knew on campus would say, "I saw you last night on television," or "I just happened to be flipping through channels and there you were." And so that was really kind of wonderful. That made me realize, I guess, how many people watch television, and also that there are a community of people out there interested. Actually, I feel like I should take the camera and turn it around and video you people, because you are the creative community, or you make the creative community, and we're very appreciative of that.
I think the thing that was so surprising was that when the first time we were on it, how many people said that they had seen us on it, because, you know, you do something and we might have been featured in The Independent, and hardly anybody comments on that, but we go on David's show, and it seems as if every day we ran into, you know, several people who said, "Oh, I saw you on," you know, and
yeah, we've been on separately and together, once for the book we collaborated on called The Western Horizon, in which I contributed essays and watercolor sketches and McDuff's wonderful panoramic photos, and then Russ Spencer Bison Films made a movie about the making of that, and so we were on for that, and then
the Book of Santa Barbara,
which is the Book of Santa Barbara, and that's McDuff's book about people and places in Santa Barbara.
Yes, well, let me say, fare thee well. It was a fabulous program. It was intimate, and it was deep, and it was intelligent, and the interviewer had done his work, which means that the poet or the person interviewed felt celebrated and felt grateful to have had such a fine reader. Because you're a fine reader. And I remember walking out of your interview show and going, "I'm a star." And it felt fantastic. So thank you, David.
We don't actually have a TV. And so it'll be interesting to have people suddenly say, "Hey, we saw you. We saw you on the TV." And they'll be flipping through the channels, and they won't even have realized that there was a creative community, and then it gets them
the show.
Yeah. Maybe the place.
Yes, that's true.
But it gives them an opportunity to watch the show, not only because I'm on it, but then they learn about it, and then they learned about other people that were on it. So I think it's got that wonderful cascading beneficial effect, and it's been really good. So I can't wait for the next chapter. Thank you, David. Thank you, creative community. The people who've been part of the creative community for many years.
Behind the camera, too.
Behind the camera. And go Equality. Go SCOTUS.
Do you know, it always made me feel important, because I'd be walking along State Street and someone I wouldn't know say, "We saw you on television last week." I said, "Oh, really? What was I doing?" And they said, "You were on the creative community." I said, "Oh, I did that about a year ago." And they said, well, we catch you whenever we can. So it, I mean, I just, what a wonderful thing that David did for the whole community, for all the artists. And I think he gave us not so much a name individually, but the whole feeling of the importance of arts in any community to bring it together, and that there is something going on besides politics, you know, in car sales and department store whatevers. And so it was a great service to the community, and I'm always glad to be a part of it.
Well, I remember after our wonderful Barry Spax died, David interviewed all of us, and to me that was so moving that we could pay tribute. David was right here at the time, and it would have been lost if he hadn't been able to capture our feelings about Barry.
I was on the show. I don't remember, I don't even remember the year. I would guess maybe 2009, 2010. Come on, David, you should know this stuff. Gosh, you don't remember when I was on? but I do remember, I remember hooking David up with Joyce and said, you must have this woman on your show. She's just a doll, and she's a delicious person and a great poet, and I'm so glad that that has been memorialized. Joyce was later named one of four poets in Ventura, a literary treasure by our county, and she is the one of the four who has since passed, but she was honored in that way, and it clearly made, you know, it meant a lot to her, and being on your show meant a lot to her, and she, you know, she may be one of your oldest guests. I'm going to try and not swat the flies, but when they get in there, there's just no avoiding it. But yes, I was on the show. I loved it. I had a great, great time, and I think I came back onto the show another time with someone from the Ventura Film Society, and just David's an amazing host, and all of his crew, just amazing people, and I was really grateful for the opportunity.
Feel about the show going off the air? Well, you know, everything has its life, and at some point you need to refresh things. So I think it's fine. You know, things don't live forever. We don't live forever. So I think it actually has value. I think our lives have value because they're finite. And I think the show has value because, okay, we're stopping and now you're going to do something else. So I think that's great. You don't want it to be tired. You want to come to it with a fresh attitude. So you've got all that. So now you'll do something new and great. I think that's great. So I think, you know, I celebrate all the success that you've had with this and the wonderful range of people that have benefited from being on and then also getting to watch it. So thank you.
Well, all good things must come to an end, right? You don't want it. You wouldn't ask for it. But there it is. And the thing is that it's been so thorough and it's been so extended that I really feel that there's a lot to go back and view again. And I hear that there's a further adventure coming up. So that makes me feel very happy, and I don't have to feel a sense of loss at all because I know it's going to be fantastic.
My name's Christine Penko, and I'm a poet.
Well, I am happy to hear that it's not goodbye to the concept in some ways, that the creative community will transmute into something else that's very much in the spirit of creativity and of community. And so I look forward to seeing the new manifestation of this.
Well, we're really sad that it's going, and we're really happy that it's continuing.
I love always working with the staff that you have. I mean, everybody you have working for you is totally gung-ho, totally proficient in what they are doing.
In fact, can we turn the cameras around? Come yeah. on over here, you guys.
And
they're shaking their head no.
No. it's a good crew. It's just a good vibe in the place, and everyone does their part. So it's a real collaborative thing, and I think it's great. And I'm very happy to hear that something is continuing on. I didn't know that. I thought it was just going to be dead space, but that's how little I know. So anyway,
a show in iambic pentameter, huh?
Okay. Well, thank you.
All right. Well, thank you.
I came across it completely by accident. I was flipping channels and thought, whoa, there's David, you know, and you were my teacher at my first poetry class I ever took. And so I watched it, and then I sort of tuned into it again, and I loved seeing different people and people that I didn't know on it, and I loved the way you conducted the interviews with them, and I thought it was just, again, sort of a thing of bringing poetry and writing out there. And I hope that in some fashion you continue something like that. So.
Oh, David's such a nice guy. David makes you feel like he really cares, like he's read your work, that he's interested in what you're doing. It's like, you know, it's like a husband, a good husband. He's a good interviewer.
It's very nice the way David likes bringing people together and honoring creative people and showing that they're appreciative in their community. Thank you, David, for everything you've done. You've just been amazing, and I love you. We love you.
David, I want to say thank you for the contributions you've made to the community, well, the creative community, and I hold no hard feelings against you. And actually, I'm pleased that you had my wife on several times, because now everybody thinks that I'm very well married. And so thank you all, and we hope that, we wish David a tremendous amount of luck in his next endeavor.
Oh, I think it's marvelous. It's David and his crew have a way of finding out, you know, what's going on and kind of a current in the rhythm of the town, and asking people from all different practices to come on his show and talk about it. And he's so relaxed and easygoing that even if you're nervous at first, you stop being nervous and you just talk. And the range of people that he's had on the show in different disciplines and with different interests, I think is fantastic, and we're gonna miss it. We're gonna miss it. And I hope that somebody picks up the gauntlet and carries this forward, because
I really enjoyed being interviewed by David because he's so gracious. And the other fortunate thing I had was I was interviewed right after Paul Willis, and seemed to have all this really positive energy. I really appreciated that. And let me think. It was kind of humorous when David was reeling off the titles of my work, and I said, no, I don't think that's right, but then I found out he was right. So that's kind of, he went with it very naturally, so that was kind of sweet. But I felt very comfortable, and many people have said they've seen the show and were really excited about the interview. It's not something I had done much before, so I was happy to have that support in my own work. Even recently, someone who I emailed went to my website, I have the link there, and they said, hey, that was a great interview. And I'm like, wow, someone goes to your website and watches your interview, that's pretty great. So,
working with David is about, it's almost as not quite as good as working with God, but close to it. Because he is the most wonderful person in the world to have you feel really like you count, you know, and like what you write is important and you really have something to say, when indeed you may not at all, but he pretends you do. And he's a great interviewer, and I've always enjoyed being on the creative community so much, and that's why I'm here, because I want to thank him for being my good friend and a marvelous poet who always inspires me. Barry and I interviewed David when David became Poet Laureate, and you know, I was signing off, and David, you know, came aboard, and we had this great idea that Barry and I would interviewed David. And I realized how hard it was to interview. And David made it look so easy, but it was so fun to be in that other position to honor him. And of course, Barry was always wonderful, and it was a great thing for us to do together, and I wish he were here.
I really do think David's the creative genius in our community. And what I love is that he promotes all of us. Like if he's putting an anthology together, he asks all of us for a poem. And so he's so generous that it makes us all want to share more of what we have and what we can contribute.
Oh, okay. Oh, okay. Well, I think David is a piece of work. No, David is a wonderful fellow. I was sorry I hadn't known him before, because he's very intelligent. He has many skill sets. He's a good poet and teacher, and he was, you know, I was very comfortable being on the show with him. And I don't think I really knew the show before, mostly because I didn't have cable anymore. and I had a really old television, so I couldn't even get the local channels. That's how pathetic I am. But, what's the form going to be now? What's going to happen now? Is it going to exist in another format? I think it should continue. It's a great thing. I mean, I think there should be I've often thought there should be a history of Santa Barbara artists. And I realize, you know, you're doing, writers, and I mean, it's an incredible community of people, of talented people. So I think it's great that it continue. I think it's important that it continue.
The crew who is creating this work is typical of the high quality of staff that we have at TVSB. These guys are so professional. I've been watching them for a while today, and as always, they're at their professional best. They're very composed, they're very together, they're very focused, and it's because of people like them that the TVSB programming is TV worth watching.
I wanted to toast David Snarky of the Creative County. I think Creative County is easily one of the best news shows on radio now, and I think we'll miss him, absolutely. Good luck, yeah. David Snarky. I hope your next gig is almost as successful. Cheers.
I think when I accidentally ran into Hap Freund and Guy Smith back in 2004, and they were talking about having a show that would interview creative people, that I was mostly thinking about myself. I was like, oh, this is great. I can be on TV. And I think maybe that's something that happens a lot on TVSB. But I think my transformation was a lot like what happens to other hosts. And that is, ultimately, I realized that the people that I was talking to were more interesting and more important than I was. And so over time, I gradually gave more and more space to those people. And I think that was the right thing to do. It was just 11 years that I would never give back, 11 years that I have cherished, and I thank the people who came out today so much for all the kind things they said. I feel like I was blessed with a crew that was genius from first to last, and it has been one of the best experiences of my life. I'd like to say goodbye to everybody. David Starkey, we'll see you later.